And sound from the forces of darkness, and as all right-thinking people know, civilization itself and realism will stand or fall together. So here to defend the good and the true and the just is Stavros.
Thank you. Now, it's always a pleasure to be introduced by someone like you. Let me start with a couple of announcements. There's a small problem with the remote for the slides, although with only quotations for the slides, so I can read them out. Let me say that this is my penultimate presentation as a Rothman Canada Research Chair in philosophy. The ultimate is going to be in a few weeks from now, so I'm leaving Canada in a few weeks, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank the Rothman Institute and the Department of Philosophy and the University of Western Ontario for a greatly stimulating, intellectually engaging atmosphere. It's been a terrific year. I wish it had been a lot longer than that. Things not work out the way we expect they do, but that's right. And we learn, being realists, we learn to actually cope with things as they come. So a big thank you, really, to everybody for being here this early Saturday morning on this lovely day, and to the whole hierarchy of Western University structure, from the top to the bottom. So. Let's do some business now. It's going to be a strange talk because I'm going to give you roughly the table of contents of the book I'm writing on metaphysics. And it's pretty much in progress in the sense that I have not really decided what to think about it. So I'm going to try to explore some ideas about the factuality of metaphysics. But I'll start with an example that I think everybody in this room, for some time at least in their intellectual lives, have asked the question, what is the law of nature? And before we ask this question, or in order to ask this question, we assume that there are laws of nature, and then we ask, what are they? And we need to take care, we need to know that this is not a perennial question. That's not a question that the ancient Greeks asked, for instance. That's a question that started to be asked in the 17th century. I don't quite know the history, but it was mostly Descartes and his followers that started to think thoroughly about nature being governed by laws. And one might worry or wonder what made this shift, this make asking this question possible. And I think that what made asking this question possible was a major shift in the way we view the world. It was a shift from nature's to laws, or a shift from Aristotelianism to what I want to defend, Malebranchism. You know, Malebranchism, you know, Father Malebranche was the true founder of the intellectual movement that I think, you know, most of modern philosophy really shares in. I will discuss this in some detail as we go on. For the time being, I want to discuss the nature of the question, what is the law of nature? Very briefly, this is a question in the so-called metaphysics of science, but what exactly is the metaphysics of science? So here is a very rough guide on the question of law. There are various ways to characterize the disagreement about laws. So one dimension is there a law-making property or not? And here there is a split, of course, as always in philosophy. The Armstrong-Gretzky-Tully approach, I'm going to use terminology. I'm sure most of you, if not all of you, know that probably better than I do, so I'm going to be quick about the definitions and the concepts, but we can discuss some of them in the discussion if you want. So the ADT view, Armstrong-Gretzky-Tully approach, as well as primitivism, I think Tim Modlin and John Carroll are kind of primitivists about laws, think there is a law-making relation, but they disagree on what this is. So the Armstrong-Gretzky-Tully approach takes laws to be necessitating relations among natural universals. Primitivists, on the other hand, think that laws are only primitive. They are real nonetheless. The law-making property is not analyzable in terms of non-nomic facts. Tim Modlin, as far as I understand him, says something like fundamental laws of temporal evolution. They're really fundamental, they produce and explain whatever regularity there is in the world. On the other hand, you've got the Humean approach and the necessitarians, the metaphysical necessitarians about views, who think that there is not a lawmaking or a sui generis lawmaking a relation. But they disagree again on what, on why there is not, or why there is no need for it. So the Humean approach roughly takes laws to be ultimately cosmic accidents, regularities. What distinguishes them ultimately from accidents are various conditions of robustness. I think the favorite, the most important, the most worked out approach is the Milne-Ramsey-Lewis approach, which takes it that laws from a system, the best system, etc., etc. But metaphysical necessitarians also, this position of the essentialists, Steve Manford, Sawyer, take laws to be to flow directly through the powers of things, so there is no need to posit an extra relationship, which makes something a law. The powers are enough. So that's one dimension. Another dimension is, are laws contingent or are laws necessary? Here again, you see the differences. The ADT approach, the Armstrong, Gretzky, Lewis approach, agrees with Humeans now that laws are contingent. That is, that they characterize the actual world and not necessarily any other possible world. They might, but it's not necessarily the case that they hold in other possible worlds. The metaphysical necessitarians of all stripes, on the other hand, agree or claim that laws are metaphysically necessary. That is, they hold, and hence they have modal implications in all possible worlds, of which the properties from which they flow are denizens. A third dimension about about laws is, are laws supervenient or non-legal, nomological facts, or are they not supervenient? Now, the Humeans agree with the necessitarians that laws are supervenient or non-legal facts, though of course they disagree on what these are, regularities versus powers. The ADT view and primitivism align with the claim that laws are non-supervenient or non-legal facts. And there is a final question, there is a final dimension, are there laws in the first place? And here everybody but my good friend Steve Manford think that there are laws, but there are still people who think about laws who think that there are no laws. So, look from the outside, the situation is pretty messy. I would say quite crazy. I do not propose to resolve it in this talk, though I have my own views, as you know, as to what is the preferred approach. I want to stress, and that's the key element of this talk, that this kind of debate within the metaphysics of science presupposes that there is a fact of the matter as to which is the correct approach, and that by some means or other, we, philosophers, can find out the correct approach. But is this so? Is metaphysics of science a factual endeavor? What is the very status of metaphysics of science? So, in what follows, I hope I'm going to do it, I'm going to skip quite a bit of if I cannot. I'm going to tell you a philosophical story, the thing that I love to do the last few years, which aims to cast light on this question, the factuality of the metaphysics of science. What light is cast, we will see in the conclusion of the story. But keep in mind throughout that the idea that there are laws of nature of which we should ask the question, what are they, was not there from the beginning of inquiry, though the laws themselves perhaps were there from the beginning of inquiry even before. Now, the next section, which is the most, you know, kind of lengthy one, is, I call it Metaphysics of Science in Search of an Object. Now, we all know that we owe the word metaphysics to a historical accident. Those who classified Aristotle's corpus put some of his treatises after the physics treatises. So they called them metaphysica, after the physics. And that's the word metaphysics was actually coined. It's got to do with the classification of the Aristotelian corpus. So you might think what metaphysics is, but I find this account, how does it work? Does it work? Colin, in his wonderful book on metaphysics, I think, he says metaphysics characterizes metaphysics as to think in a systematic or orderly fashion about the subjects that Aristotle discussed in the group of three theses collectively known by that name. So Aristotle called what we call metaphysics first philosophy, proto philosophia, and that's very misunderstood, it seems to me, especially by those who coined the very ugly expression second philosophy. Very ugly in my view, but anyway. So it's the kind of inquiry that Aristotle called first philosophy, which is logically and conceptually prior to physics and other sciences, but historically, temporarily posterior to them, since its very possibility presupposes the subject matters of the special sciences as sciences of the principles and causes of particular kinds of being. First philosophy then studies the being qua being, Aristotle says, that is the being stripped of particular scientific descriptions of it. And that's a very famous quotation from metaphysics. There is a science which investigates being as being and the attributes which belong to this in virtue of its own nature. Now, this is not the same as any of the so-called special sciences, for none of these deals generally with being as being. They cut off a part of being and investigate the attributes of this part. This is what mathematical sciences, for instance, do. Now, since we are seeking the first principles and the highest causes, clearly there must be something to which these belong in virtue of its own nature. Now, if you think about what Aristotle was doing, Aristotelian categories are only categories. They capture what there is, or better, they capture the only signature of what there is. For instance, colloquially thinking about the world broadly, we think of it as being as having properties and having individuals in it. And this distinction is captured by Aristotle by a fundamental ontic distinction between universals and particulars. There are supposedly essential properties and accidental properties, and this distinction is captured by Aristotle by the difference between substantial and non-substantial universals. So disputes about ontic categories are factual disputes. For instance, you can see the discussion the criticism he makes of Plato about the relationship between particulars and universals. There's supposed to be a fact of the matter as to what comes first, what is the order of dependence. Disputes about ontic categories for Aristotle are not free floaters. They're grounded in the scientific account of the world, but they are not read directly from it. Rather, they lay bare the ontological categories that are presupposed by the scientific account of the world. For instance, you can think of Aristotle's account of causation as aiming to describe the ways the concept is used in science as well as in everyday life, and at the same time to provide a unified account of the various ways and the metaphysical underpinning of this account of causation, his famous hylomorphism. Disputes about ontic categories are disputes about theoretical entities that play an explanatory role and are ultimately accepted on this basis. His introduction of potentiality is meant actually to ground and explain the possibility of change in nature. So what I think is Aristotle's metaphysics of science is the study of the ontic categories and principles that constitute the nature of things, and in particular the dynamic character of this nature, that is, it's the powers things have to bring about certain natural behaviors. So the metaphysics of science, in a nutshell, has as its aim to study the structure of natural necessity. This is the enterprise Aristotle makes possible. That's what I think it takes to be metaphysics of science. Let's move a little bit forward now in time and go to Middle Ages. And there you've got this, the battery is there, but anyway, it doesn't matter. It's a long story, but I call it the medieval split. Here is a principle introduced by a great, really great mind, Duns Scotus. Whatever occurs in many instances by a cause that is not free, is not an agent or God, a secondary cause, in other words, is the natural effect of that cause. So he used this principle as a means to bridge the gap between regular behavior and natural causes. But he knew very well that all general statements arrived at by means of this principle can be denied without contradiction. Actually, God himself could violate it, if he will, to do so. So they make clear some conception which is already there in Aristotle, but they make it quite an important conception about nature, and the, what I call the key position, the behavior of things, that is unfree natural causes, is determined by their powers. So Scotus used the term aptitude or power, and his favorite example, one of his favorite examples, is the herb of this species is hot. He doesn't do quantum gravity, he talks about, you know, herbs. We can do anything we can do with quantum gravity, we can do with herbs when it comes to the metaphysics of science, and conversely, when it comes to the basic structure, I think. So the best we can get from experience is that the herb of this species is suited by nature to be hot. That is, it has the aptitude for an effect. This implies that Scotus's principle yields regularities in the world only if nothing prevents the nature of an object to manifest itself. But there can be exceptions if something prevents the nature from acting. And God could certainly do that. So general statements about powers are only naturally necessary and not metaphysically necessary. And you see this move also in nominalists. Buridan, did not hypostatize powers, nor did he endorse an essentialist view of natural kinds. Still, he thought the universal principles of science are not absolutely necessary in the sense that their denial would not lead to a contradiction. Mm-hmm. To accommodate the sui generis status, he introduced explicitly the idea of natural necessity. This is the kind of necessity which could be violated by God. As he put it, there is another necessity, which is called natural, which is not necessity simpliciter, but which could be necessity with all supernatural cases put to one side. So for these guys, natural necessity is necessity enough when you think of nature, provided God does not choose to intervene. So a big common medieval assumption is that natural processes are running their natural courses, and this is supposed to exclude the miraculous intervention of God. But what we've got here for the first time, it seems to me, is a split between metaphysical necessity on the one hand and natural necessity on the other hand. And the metaphysics of science was then taken to be, to have as a subject matter, the principles and only categories that are required for there being natural necessity in the world, barring God's interventions. Natural necessity without metaphysical necessity. Note that the very idea of the difference between metaphysical necessity and natural necessity makes possible the denial of a special subject matter for the metaphysics of science. That is the very denial of natural necessity as a distinct kind of necessity. And the first who did that, he's relatively unknown, but he was a great mind, we don't know a lot about him, is this medieval philosopher Nicolaus or Nicolas Baudricourt, who actually argued for the first time that the appeal to natural necessity is only verbal and the only constraint in theorizing should be logical necessity. So either metaphysical necessity or nothing. And metaphysical necessity is captured basically by the structure of logical necessity. The next step in my narrative is now Descartes and Malebranche. Now, Descartes thought explicitly about the metaphysics of physics, and he offered this wonderful account of what is metaphysics of science, or what is metaphysics, yeah. No, that's the last one. That's karma. Sorry. It's a lot of time between karma and Descartes. Yeah, you know that. That's a wonderful quotation. Thus, all philosophies like a tree on which metaphysics is the root, physics the trunk, and all the other sciences the branches that grow out of this trunk, which are reduced to three principal, namely medicine, mechanics, and ethics. And that's actually from the French translation. It was not in the Latin translation, original of the famous Principia Philosophica. But what Descartes does is that he kind of epistemologized first philosophy, Aristotelian first philosophy, the quest for the principles and hence the possibility of knowledge. However, metaphysics is also a network of only categories, and you all know substance and attributes, some of which are essential and others accidental. So the structure of only categories is an only structure that delimits the empirical models of the world. Hence, physics has a double ground in metaphysics for Descartes. Scientific knowledge by physics presupposes metaphysical principles which secure its possibility, and The natural world has an underlying ontic structure. It is a matter, or it is matter, or substance, which is essentially characterized by extension, and the world is inherently geometrical and inert. Motion comes from the outside. So God there is important for the following two reasons. He bridges the gap between these two roles of metaphysics. He guarantees the knowledge of the world and is the source of all motion in nature. But there can be and is, for Descartes, a priori knowledge of the basic metaphysical necessary structure of the world by us humans and by scientists. God warrants the fundamental laws of nature and their a priori knowability. From the immutability of God to the fundamental law of the conservation of quantity of motion in the universe. You know that, I mean, Descartes thought that the fundamental law of conservation of energy flows directly from the immutability of God, and therefore the three fundamental laws of motion are grounded in God directly. There's a crucial question then. How is science possible? Actually, what exactly is the role of science in this framework? And Descartes goes on to write books, third and fourth of the Principia, and to explain his own scientific account of the world. But the idea is this: the possible empirical models of the world are restricted from above by a priori and metaphysically necessary principles, the fundamental laws of nature, and from below by experience. So between these two constraints, from above and from below, these two, there are various theoretical hypotheses which can constitute the proper subject of science. Now, for Descartes, two metaphysical disputes are factual disputes. Their factuality is guaranteed by God, that is, by the deep structure of the world, and as this is laid out by God and the three fundamental laws of nature, he legislates. Dispute about ontic categories are independent of the scientific account of the world, but they are presupposed by it in the sense that they delimit the possible scientific accounts of the world from above. Disputes about ontic categories are disputes about theoretical entities that play an explanatory role. But the only categories are ultimately accepted by means of intuition and a priori argument. And Cartesian metaphysics, of course, is a move from powers to laws. Science investigates the mechanical structure of the world and the laws of nature by virtue of which things behave the way they do. These laws are metaphysically necessary, but some of them are known a priori, whereas others are known only a posteriori. So the metaphysics of science has as its key target to study the laws of nature. That's for the first time in intellectual history, where these laws are metaphysically necessary, though a lot of them are known only a posteriori. So one kind of necessity, metaphysical necessity, but two kinds of certainty for Descartes, metaphysical and moral. Now, here's my hero, Marc Brandt. Marc Brandt completes the move from natures to laws of nature. So he calls, famously, pure chimera, Aristotle's idea of nature. That is the idea that things have natures in virtue of which they behave of necessity the way they do. When someone says that, for instance, the fire burns by its nature, they do not know what they mean, Marc Brandt says. Marc Brandt suggested that the replacement of the idea of power with the idea, actually suggested the replacement of the idea of power with the idea of natural law. To the claim that powers are needed to explain why things behave the way they do, why, for instance, fire burns and does not cool like water, he replied that insofar as the laws of nature are fixed, the things that obey them will behave in a certain way and not otherwise. And this, of course, is because the fixity of laws implies the fixity of properties that the various things have. However, the laws themselves are established by God, who wills them to be the case. What does this make of science, then? In Elucidation 15, Marc Brandt explained very carefully what the recourse to God as the universal cause, should not be had when explanation of particular effects is sought. So when we try to explain a concrete effect, for instance, why the air dries the earth, or why it freezes the water, it would be ridiculous, Marc Brandt says, to say that it is God that does this. Instead, we should offer explanations in terms of the natural and particular cause of the effects in question, which might well include the mechanical micro causes. For Marc Brandt, the natural causes that feature in the causal explanation of an effect do not have in themselves any force or power to produce any effect. So qua explanation, the explanation of the effect is false. The true causal explanation lies in the will of God, Van Grant says, which is the only true moral force. But the explanation is not false qua an explanation that states various regularities and laws that govern the behavior to be explained, the effect to be explained. Hence, nomological explanations of various effects are possible and science should look for them. The way I read Van Grant, what he denies is that there is a species of causal explanation in science which is distinct from nomological explanation. And this denial is based on the denial of the premise that there is a distinct species of necessity, natural necessity, that is necessity grounded on the natures and powers of things in the world. If there is no distinct kind of natural necessity, whatever is left of the metaphysics of science goes into the categories that are needed to understand the structure and the function of laws of nature. So what if there is no natural necessity, distinct kind of necessity? If the road is open for denying natural necessity, that is, for denying that secondary causes have powers in virtue of which they stand in productive relations to their effects, the question that crops up is this: what if God is altogether left out of the picture? What if the world is left to its own devices, as it were? So I think Van Grant was really important in the intellectual history of our metaphysics, you know, of metaphysics of science, because Van Grant makes possible Hume and Humeans. So leave God out of the picture and all you have are regularities and no natural necessity whatsoever. So the very idea, the ancient idea of a rational entailment between distinct existences goes by the board. Metaphysics, qua the study of natural necessity, becomes pointless. There are no sui generis facts that the metaphysics of science is supposed to study. Now, there are two ways to read Hume. One is to think of Hume as an error theorist. The scientific account of the world taken at face value presupposes natural necessities grounded in the natures and powers of things, but there are no such things, hence the scientific account of the world is in error, massive error. However, and I've got some quotations, I'm going to skip them, you can actually read Hume as a reformist. The scientific account of the world can be reformed in such a way that it does not imply any commitments to suspicious metaphysical categories and heavyweight entities such as powers. So when he talks about necessity, he's got claims like uniformity forms the very essence of necessity. Now, can we skip in two slides? Yeah, that's a wonderful quotation, and it's pretty critical Kant. I think it says it all. The rain never follows the wind because of the law of identity. And the Kantian reaction, of course, is that a new issue is now available. How is it possible that there are natural necessary connections which are not logically necessary connections? This has been severed by Hume. So how is that possible? How can we account for this? And the move from the pre-critical Kant to the critical Kant is a move towards a certain way to approach this kind of question as a question in the metaphysics of science. Not by inflating the ontology in terms of powers, though you can imagine there is a line of interpretation of Kant which says that Kant was a great believer in powers and disposition, that's very contentious. So it's not by inflating ontology that Kant tries to answer this question of natural necessity, but by inflating epistemology. I'm going to skip the next quotation. It's a famous quotation about the status of the principle that every alteration must have a cause as a condition for our understanding. What's important is that the subject matter of the metaphysics of science now is the synthetic a priori principles that are constitutive of the object of science and are required for the very possibility of experience and the scientific knowledge in particular. And natural necessity is supposed to be one of those principles, even if it is reduced to its bare bones, that is, the principle that everything that happens that it begins to be presupposes something upon which it follows by a rule, which if you think as a principle is consistent with an array of different views about what the rules and laws of nature are supposed to be. So Kant engages in what Peter Strossel has aptly called descriptive metaphysics of science, assuming that current science, that is Newton's science theories in Kant's era, get the world right, The content of descriptive metaphysics, to paraphrase Strawson, is to describe the actual structure of our scientific account of the world. Kant does not for a moment doubt that our commitment to natural necessity is so entwined with our ordinary concept of causation that the task of metaphysics of science is to make clear the conditions in possible experience that make this commitment possible. But there is a sense in which Kant goes beyond descriptivism. Metaphysics of the sort Kant promoted, the science of synthetic a priori principles, was taken to constitute an a priori reduction of empirical possibilities. That is a reduction of the positive theoretical motives of the world, if the world is knowable at all. But then a lot depends on the kind, on the status of principles that are supposed to be required for the very possibility of experience and the subsequent reduction of the theoretical models of the world. The story of the non-Euclidean geometries made it abundantly clear that Kant's thought that synthetic a priori principles are necessarily true and atemporal was wrong, or at least debatable. So Kant relocated the content of metaphysics of science, and at least temporarily, he saved it until the revolution in physics and maths in the beginning of the 19th century. So he saved metaphysics of science from the Malebranche Hume criticism that if natural necessity is lost, it has no special subject matter anymore. But we know Kant was a big victory. So I'm going to be extremely brief in the next section in the interest of time. So if you think in the 20th century there's an oscillation, you've got the logical empiricists on the one hand, famously eliminating or trying to eliminate metaphysics. Metaphysics is meaningless, so metaphysical disputes are non-factual disputes. They are nonsensical disputes. Metaphysics has no subject matter. It's a subject with no object. They thought verificationism is a weapon against metaphysics. Of course, even with the logical empiricism, there's a kind of a purification thesis, which corresponds to Hume's reform. The apparently metaphysical concepts as used in science have a valid residue when stripped of their metaphysical content. So Karma famously distinguished between, when he was thinking about causation already in 1928, the Aufbau between the essence problem, which is a metaphysical problem because it purports to investigate what the alleged essence of causation is beyond regularity, and the correlation problem, which he thought is the problem of identifying laws of nature. So even later, Carnap thought that what he took Hume's prime aim was to purify, but not to reject the concept of causation, where the object of the purification was to free causation from the component of necessity. So there is this tendency between elimination and purification, and of course there's Quine, and if we put Quine's program in a nutshell, I would call it dissolving metaphysics. So metaphysics, by and large, is ontology. Ontology is an answer to the question, what is there? And this kind of question, what is there, is asked within or from within the scientific image of the world, and its answer is given by Quine's famous criterion of ontological commitment. But given this dipole, given this oscillation between dissolution and elimination, natural necessity strikes back. And in the 1960s and 70s, natural necessity strikes back in two stages. Natural necessity without metaphysical necessity, which is the Armstrong-Gretzky Tuning view of laws, and natural necessity is metaphysical necessity. This is the view that laws of nature are metaphysically necessary. So both views, natural necessity is metaphysical necessity, natural necessity is distinct from metaphysical necessity, take it that the metaphysics of science is a factual enterprise that has as its subject matter the fabric of natural necessity. Or in other words, the only categories that are required for the nomological structure of the world. Both views take it that there is more to the world than regularity and that laws are distinct from regularities. Both views take it that there are regularity enforcers in the actual world. Both views take it that disputes about only categories are disputes about theoretical entities that play an explanatory role and are ultimately accepted on this basis. But of course they disagree on the relevant only categories that are required for the structure of natural necessity. They agree that part of the lawmakers should be universal, standing in some kind of relation of entailment to each other, but they disagree on the modal scope of the relation of entailment, as well as on the very nature of the universals themselves. Notably, the metaphysics of the metaphysical necessitation view takes the lawmaker, if you like, to be powers or dispositions, and hence it takes that laws are metaphysically necessary. Put in a nutshell, the difference between these two approaches is the following. On the metaphysical necessitation approach, natural necessity is metaphysical necessity, whereas on the ADT approach, they are distinct. There is natural necessity without metaphysical necessity. But then history repeats itself. And it repeats itself via the neo-Humean or Louisian approach. Because this suggests that A, we cannot make sense of a natural necessitation relation among universals, and B, the stronger metaphysical necessitation approach relies on a problematic, if not outright wrong, metaphysics of non-trivial or non-logical relations of entailment and exclusion between distinct existences. My point is not to adjudicate who is right and who is wrong. My point is that all these approaches work or rely on a common assumption, namely that the metaphysics of science is a factual enterprise and that there is a fact of the matter as to which approach to locus is the correct one. So let me speak a little bit more about the substance of the reaction. And this is, one may wonder, is this assumption correct? Is metaphysics factual? And there are two ways, interestingly, in which the factuality of metaphysics has been reconceptualized, I think. Not denied, but reconceptualized. And the first one, let's go a little bit, there's a table. There it is. I mean, you all know that. That's Carnap's famously in Empiricist Semantics and Ontology, 1950. He's got this matrix. There are questions which are external or internal and theoretical and practical, and he wants to exclude external theoretical questions. That's the only category which is empty in Carnap's view. What are they? Questions about the reality of a type of entity that are supposed to be settled by looking for empirical evidence for the reality of this type, or by insight into the metaphysical structure of the world, and whose answer is supposed to be the content of a belief-like proposition. So questions concerning the reality of the type of entity are legitimate and have content, but only if they are taken to be either practical external questions concerning the benefits for adopting a certain framework, which includes this type of entity in its basic only inventory, or internal theoretical questions concerning the evidence there is for, or other reasons for accepting the reality of a certain instances of this entity. So Carnap famously specifies various conditions for this to be possible. I'm gonna skip them over. On this view, and that's the important bit now, metaphysical assertions are not factual assertions in the sense that they are not meant to respond to an independently given realm of sui generis metaphysical facts. But they can be seen as quasi-factual insofar as they are meant to be assertions about the choice of a linguistic framework that allows us to talk about certain only categories. And they are factual insofar as they are seen as assertions within a certain already chosen framework. Similarly, metaphysical disputes are not factual disputes insofar as they are taken to be disputes about an independently given ontological signature of reality. But they're quasi-factual disputes insofar as they concern the theoretical and practical advantages, always relative to a name, of choosing one framework over the other. In other words, metaphysical disputes are factual not in the sense of responding to an independently given metaphysical reality, but in the sense that there is typically a fact of the matter as to what kind of framework best serves a certain aim. Getting to this fact of the matter will rely on usual theoretical virtues. Now, can we go not to the next, the one after the next? Yeah, okay. This way of reconceptualizing metaphysics is meant to liberate metaphysical theorizing by making the theorizing in the service of science and of our theoretical understanding of the world. Crudely put, metaphysical pluralism is to the service of science. This is an astonishing quotation at the end of the show. People don't pay too much attention, especially in the first few lines. the acceptance or rejection of abstract linguistic forms, just as the acceptance or rejection of any ordinary, of any other linguistic forms, in any branch of science will finally be decided by their efficiency as instruments, the ratio of the results achieved to the amount and complexity of the efforts required. And that's pretty well known. But what follows is really astonishing. To decree dogmatic prohibitions of certain linguistic forms instead of testing them by their success or failure in practical use is worse than futile. It is positively harmful because it may obstruct scientific progress. The history of science shows examples of such prohibitions based on prejudices deriving from religious, mythological, metaphysical, or other irrational sources which slow down the development for shorter or longer periods of time. So I think Carnap says, let us learn the lesson from history. Let us grant that those who work in any special field of investigation the freedom to use any form of expression which seems useful to them, the work in the field will sooner or later lead to the elimination of those forms which have no useful function. Let us be cautious in making assertions and critical in examining them, but tolerant in permitting linguistic forms. So the reference to history of science is, and its lesson is not accidental. If metaphysical disputes are taken to be factual disputes that respond to an independently given metaphysical claim, the history of science is either a history of failures to understand the metaphysical signature of the world, or the history of our ignorance of the metaphysical signature. Besides, if we assume ahead of the scientific inquiry that there is an independently given fact of the matter about the metaphysical signature of the world, the scientific inquiry will be constrained by whatever conceptions there are of this signature. The scientific findings will have to conform to the signature rather than the metaphysical signature to conform to the scientific findings. Now, I put it to you that Carnap, by this account, liberates metaphysical theorizing by reconceptualizing it. He issues no prohibitions to it, and he offers a criterion of comparison between different metaphysical accounts. The success of a framework is a function of the ratio of the results achieved to the amount and complexity of the efforts required. So far from banning metaphysics, Carnap's approach legitimizes it by A, offering a criterion of success, and B, allowing metaphysical exploration. Far from being arbitrary, this liberation makes possible answering traditional metaphysical questions as they have been reconceptualized and not as traditionally understood. For as Carnap put it, let us grant to those who work in any special field of investigation the freedom to use any form of expression which seems useful to them. Their work in the field will sooner or later lead to the elimination of those forms which have no useful function. So the elimination of forms is simply the elimination of wanted frameworks that fare worse in fulfilling the aims that are meant for. So we may say that for Carnap, metaphysics, suitably reconceptualized, has a subject matter after all. And this is the study of wanted frameworks that can be put to the service of science and the criterion of acceptance only insofar as they play this role sufficiently well and better than their rivals. So I'm going to draw to a close, but there is, I'm going to very, very quickly tell you about the second reconceptualization. We don't know about that because analytic philosophers don't pay attention to this kind of tradition, but this philosopher of history, Robin Collingwood, introduced a different way to reconceptualize metaphysics by thinking that metaphysics has a subject matter, but it's historical. So he takes metaphysics to be the science of dealing with the absolute presuppositions underlying ordinary science. So metaphysics qua ontology is a name for a mistake, Collingwood says. Metaphysics has no as a subject matter the absolute presuppositions of the various scientific theories and scientific frameworks. So all metaphysical questions from Collingwood are historical questions. All metaphysical propositions are historical propositions. So when we look at causation, we should look at what people thought about causation, what accounts of causation were suitable or accepted as presupposed by various scientific theories. So metaphysical assertions are factual assertions insofar as they are historical assertions. Metaphysical disputes are factual disputes, but only insofar as being historical disputes. So here's the final thought, a couple of minutes and I'm done. What if we bring Carnap and Collingwood together? Carnapian frameworks can be seen as based on absolute presuppositions which, if there are questions, questioned or challenged, the whole framework collapses. So you cannot question the existence of numbers while you do arithmetic. Treating the absolute presuppositions as constitutive of the framework overcomes Collingwood's problematic thought that absolute presuppositions have no values. But by the same token, trying to do externalist metaphysics is engaging in what Collingwood called pseudo-metaphysics. Collingwood highlights the importance of a descriptive historical approach to metaphysics, looking at various scientific theories and practices and unravel the absolute presuppositions, what was presupposed for making scientific sense of the world. As such, Collingwood goes beyond the epistemological positivist account of metaphysics as meaningless, as well as the quine and disillusion of metaphysics. Carnap, on the other hand, highlights the importance of exploring Ontic frameworks and examining which of them best serves the aim it was adopted for, e.g. making sense of the nomological structure of the world. Carnap's approach is not descriptive, but what I call conceptual explorative. As such, Carnap goes beyond Collingwood in taking it that metaphysics, properly understood as conceptual exploration of Ontic frameworks, is forward-looking. So the factuality of metaphysics is then doubly reconceptualized. Metaphysics of science is a factual enterprise, not in the sense of aiming to capture the Ontic signature of the world. There might not be such a signature, or you might have to be agnostic about that. It is factual in the sense that it studies historical and conceptual forms, attempts to make scientific sense of the world and their presuppositions. So I finish with a question which I don't quite know how to answer, but it's an important question to me. What would we miss if we conceptualize the factuality of metaphysics along the lines I suggested for the Carnap and Collingwood? Thank you.
Okay, time for questions. Winnie.
Thank you for that, for example. I'm very sympathetic to your suggestion of the end of the sort of, you know, merging of Collingwood and Carnap. My question is, though, if that's the conception of metaphysics we have, what happens to the sorts of debates that you introduced your talk with, debates about the nature of the laws of nature? Because if I'm looking at Carnap's recommendations, well, you know, what kind of conception would be good for science? It seems to me that most physicists get along talking about laws of physics without commitment to any answer to those kind of questions. You know, that they don't need a settled answer to whether they're metaphysical or dissociative metaphysical, the necessity or natural necessity or anything like that. They just, you know, work with some kind of, you know, conception of law. So do you just kind of drop out because there's no point in having an answer to it?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I'll answer it in two parts.
Okay.
The first part is if we stick to what I said, then the proper way to understand the questions is either historical or conceptual or both. So basically, and you've got the liberty to pursue them. You've got the liberty to pursue a power-based metaphysics and try to understand the elementary particles in terms of the dispositions, okay? See how far you can go in understanding scientific theories on this account. And at the same time, you're allowed to do that by trying to deny this and try to take regularity as brute or buy into the distinction between categorical and dispositional properties, as opposed to eliminating it. So the first part of the answer would be this kind of approaches should be distinctively philosophical approaches. They've got the subject matter in the sense that they study current science and they try to see what kind of frameworks are most suited or could be best suited in describing, you know, connections around, you know, issued by our scientific theories of the world. But if we thought that I'm right and you are wrong when you believe that there are dispositions, ultimately, you know, ungrounded dispositions, and I think there are not, that we're mistaken. So there's no fact of the matter as to whether ultimately there are fundamental ungrounded dispositions or not. We are allowed to explore both. Now, there is a part of the paper which I couldn't know how to finish, okay? And there's hope. And the hope is this. The hope is a kind of a Louisian hope. If all goes well, and it's very unlikely that all will go well, but if all goes well, you're going to have a final theory of the world, okay? And you're going to be at the end of inquiry. And then you're going to ask the question, is one of the frameworks we've discussed and explored now best suited for this theory? So if I introduced universals and connections among universals, do I get a kind of a simpler account, or an account which would, you know, tally better with our scientific account of the world? And if we were lucky and this were the case, this would be some reason for us to think that this is probably a better account of the blueprint, the ontic signature of the world. But it's very unlikely, given what we know, that there's going to be one unique metaphysical framework which will fit best our best scientific theory of the world. Yeah, so I mean, that's my answer. I mean, it's a bit vague as always, but.
Andre.
Thanks a lot. So I really like the historical story as concerns the idea of natural necessity and what various people said. And I wanted to see if I could press you a little bit to get some understanding of what the historical story tells us about what science and metaphysics of science are exactly. So when we talk about the metaphysics of science, one might naively think it kind of presupposes that there's this thing called science, and then we can do a metaphysics of it, and that those two things are kind of separable. Right? When you talk about history repeating itself, you know, the medieval history or early modern history repeating itself in the 20th century, it seems slightly problematic to me in that while today we think of there being science and us doing a metaphysics of it, certainly at that time, right, there was no metaphysics of science conceived in the same way. There was, in fact, physics was just part of philosophy, there was natural philosophy. So when you say that, you know, when Malebranche completes the kind of picture that Descartes had fueled, and that there was no more work for the metaphysics of philosophy to do, that seems difficult for me to get my head around, in part because philosophy and what we now call science were just intermingled, so all of science was metaphysics of science, and those things are kind of mashed together in a way that we might not want to think they are now. Now, I actually think that's a naive view of what's going on now, right? So I guess, how does the historical story help us to understand what we mean by science and metaphysics of science?
Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, in a certain sense, the historical story was meant to implicitly illustrate my, if you like, positive proposal. So you know, go back and look at the various changing conceptions of, you know, how philosophers and scientists thought about the scientific theories and the metaphysical presuppositions, whatever they were. Okay, it's one part of this story was to show that there was a common element which united all these approaches, and the common element was the thought that nature, that there is natural necessity. So, and that's part of the universe. You don't get it directly out of science. I mean, you do get it directly out of science if you've got the idea that things get dispositions or powers to behave in a certain way. So people thought that you get more or less natural necessity for free out of this. But the important point, I think, that the idea of laws of nature brought out was that you don't have to ground necessity in nature in anything like the natures of things. Okay? So it's got to be grounded, though. You see, that's a thing. And I think, and Descartes might have been doing at the same time physics and metaphysics, but he thought there's a distinct part of the enterprise, which is the grounding of the laws of nature. Okay, so laws of nature are metaphysically necessary because ultimately they're grounded in God and his attributes, his being immutable. So despite the continuity, there's a distinct role. And it seems to me what my brands and Hume make possible as an answer later, which is very important, is that we can do without the grounding. But if we do without the grounding, then we do without metaphysics as was understood previously. All we need to look at is the categories, maybe scientific categories that are necessary for understanding this idea of law of nature. Have I answered?
I think you have, but if I could just ask one quick follow-up question. Isn't doing without grounding itself grounding a metaphysical position?
Look, here's my model. No. I know how to answer that, but this is really, you know, this is the question that I feel the most pressure about. And it's, we cannot do without metaphysics. But there is a five-year motto. Have the five-year motto. If it is metaphysics, make the list of it. So, I mean, if you deny metaphysical position, you do metaphysics, okay? But a denial of a metaphysical position is a metaphysical position. In my view, if you want to work out a human conception of laws of nature, for instance, you need to do some metaphysics, but maybe you don't need to do heavy duty metaphysics. So it's not a plea to avoid doing metaphysics. I'm not saying we should do that. I don't think empiricists can avoid doing metaphysics despite their best efforts. But at least, you know, they don't have to do wild metaphysics.
No, yet. I'll put you on the list. Yeah. It's Carl's turn.
So, I'm just wondering if you can clarify sort of how much of a metaphysical anti-realist you are in the Carnapian sense, because you're talking about the possible, even your optimistic scenario, the end of scientific inquiry of physics or something like that. You're not saying that we'll know then what the right metaphysics of nature is. Maybe we won't even know whether there's anything corresponding to the idea of natural necessity at that point. And so I wonder if you could just clarify how much you go along with Carnap about metaphysical kind of anti-realism, and how much of that is motivated by epistemic doubts, or how much just by viewing the conceptual project of metaphysics as badly directed to begin with.
As I said, that's work in progress in a very honest sense. I'm not saying that to avoid this question. I'm struggling in my own understanding of philosophy, and you know, setting up my own philosophical view of the world to find a place for metaphysics in it. Okay, I think there are various historical and conceptual reasons to make us skeptical about metaphysics. And one of them is basically we don't quite know what the criterion of success is in metaphysics. What is it, you know, to have a successful metaphysical theory? And we know also that in the history as well as in current scientific theorizing, there is heavy underdetermination. That is, we don't have one metaphysical theory which fits best. So this makes me skeptical about the whole project. So for the time being, I just want to remain agnostic as opposed to an anti-realist. So, but I think being agnostic, that is, suspecting judgment about the metaphysical signature of the world, it's fully compatible with reconceptualizing metaphysical theorizing, so that you try to make the most of it. You know, you see whether you can actually use all these categories and to the service of science. So I don't describe myself as an anti-realist, more as an agnostic at this stage.
Jessica.
Really like this talk, and I basically agree with you, and then offer some other ways to think about it. I mean, you know, as I see what you're suggesting, there, Carnap's observation, really following what you just said, that, you know, it's unclear what the standards for success are in metaphysical theorizing. You know, sort of can be understood in one of two ways. Be understood in sort of counseling an anti-realist methodology or conclusion. And it's interesting that most metaphysicians, so to speak, have kind of taken up that perspective. So we have, you know, for example, in Metaphysics, this volume that Chalmers and Wasserman and Manley put together, you know, nearly all the papers are picking up on the neo-Carnapian theme as counseling an anti-realist, broadly speaking, conclusion. But I really like your alternative way of thinking about what Carnap is suggesting. which is just that, look, here's, and here's a natural being savior, broadly epistemological motivation, which is very far from the end of metaphysical inquiry right now, not just with respect to our results, but with respect to our methodology. You know, he says, well, who could ever decide between the nominalist and the realist about universals? We don't know now, but maybe down the line, with sufficient further investigations, data, considering consequences, consistency, et cetera, we'll be able to do that. So, you know, what I see you as suggesting is, an alternative way of thinking about metaphysical theorizing, which is compatible, as you say, with there being a metaphysical signature of the world. But we just shouldn't be dogmatic at this point.
No, I don't want to say that there's no metaphysical signature.
Yeah.
Who am I to say that? You know, how shall I know that? We have not managed so far to approach it. We don't have any reason to think that we're anywhere closer to knowing it. Current science and historically science has fully underdetermined answering this question, but then there are two attitudes. Either we stop to move, we go home and forget about metaphysics and all metaphysicians have become unemployed, or we reconceptualize how metaphysics is done and why it is important, and we do business as usual in a more exciting way, basically.
Okay. Could I have just a quick follow-up? So just a convenient way for me that I've been thinking about this is in terms of vertical versus horizontal dimensions of progress, right? So along the horizontal dimension, you have these different frameworks, broadly Carnapian ones that have different presuppositions. And then vertical progress consists in sort of lashing yourself to the mass of, one set of presuppositions and working within that framework. So vertical versus horizontal dimensions of progress, at this point, we don't have a right to completely insist on any vertical dimension.
I feel like you've sort of already addressed this in some of your other, but so is something people like to say to explain why philosophy has a point, and it's that philosophy is the history of future science, and one way to fit that into the picture of metaphysics as conceptual exploratory, it's conceptual exploratory not just of the history of science, but perspective. Offers frameworks.
Yeah.
And there's people that primitive ontology, quantum mechanics, tends to think about ecology or space time. Seems like conceptual exploratory metaphysics being offered as a way for science to develop in the future. I wonder if you didn't seem to foreground, you seemed to describe the causal, the conceptual exploratory based metaphysics as a backward that we want.
No.
So
it's all, this was quite explicit, I thought, probably, I did it very quickly. Carnap, what I'm going to do with Carnap is to say, look, I do that prospectively only. Try to look forward and try to explore conceptual possibilities and to the service of science. But I think it's really important for grounding the whole thing also to look backwards, to look at the history. And I think that's what Carnap suggested in a negative way. Carnap thought that if you look back in the history, we've set up prohibitions, and this can be detrimental to progress. But what I took Colin to be trying to say is that it's part of what we call metaphysics to try to make sense of the changing presuppositions about the basic categories that were accepted by the various scientific theories of common sense.
And so you call those like being kind of metaphysical ambition.
Yeah. And I think both aspects are important, and one of them should not be overemphasized against the other. Historical, descriptive, and conceptual exploratory.
Rob, thank you very much. I thought there was a point that's really raised by Wayne's question that I think is sort of still up in the air.
Uh-huh.
And that is, the principle of tolerance is really two-edged, even in the way, and perhaps especially in the way that you presented it. Because on the one hand, I would say, well, whatever a metaphysical, ontological framework is something that you're free to pursue, and we set up no prohibitions on these. On the other hand, there's this strong deflationary aspect of it. So, in a sense, it's saying, well, you can do metaphysics to the extent that it's a possible way of thinking about science that clarifies the actual work of science. You have to show us what it does. Right? And so there's a kind of anti-metaphysical criterion that's introduced by that. I mean, I'm not saying this is a criticism. From my point of view, this sounds like a good thing to do. Right? If you have a dispute in metaphysics that you can't actually show, as the principle of tolerance suggests, that it's useful in some way, that it makes some difference in how the science is done.
You cannot, you say, so.
As in, if you can't show that, then without using the same words, that's like identifying it as a kind of useless metaphysical dispute. I mean, not all metaphysicians like the idea of merely being tolerated, right?
I'd love to be tolerated in this.
Well, me too, but then that's, in a sense, that's like telling a certain kind of metaphysician, well, if what you do makes no difference to how we actually approach the subject matter in science, then you don't really have a philosophical way of answering these questions, do you? The only way of talking about whether your categorical or ontological framework is a useful one is by talking about what it actually does in science.
In the interest of time, I'll be very, very quick. I mean, that's important question. The principle of tolerance is a principle against prohibitions, but it's compatible, as you said, with criteria of success. You know, Carnap talked about eliminating forms, you know, frameworks which are not doing what they're supposed to be doing in the best way. But what I would say to colleagues who actually think that there is something really important, you know, about metaphysics, which is totally disconnected from, you know, what science does and what the understanding of the world by science is, that, you know, you're free to do that, but how is this connected in the first place with the tradition we're part of? You know, if you look at the tradition we're part of, from Aristotle on, from Plato on, what we call metaphysics has always been in contact with whatever was ascending account of the world, trying to service it without necessarily, you know, making it, trying to describe it. You know, that it was putting constraints. You know, Descartes was putting constraints. Kant was putting constraints, okay, on scientific theorizing, but it was constraints on scientific theorizing, not arbitrary models. So I would challenge them to tell me, you know, whether that's a new conception of metaphysics, and if it's a new conception of metaphysics, you know, why should I take it seriously, or if it's not a new conception, how it is connected with the tradition, which has always been the way I think I describe it.
So I'm having a hard time. I always had a hard time understanding Carnap's position as anything other than instrumentalism.
Yeah.
And I'm having a hard time really quite understanding the way the word metaphysical signature is being used. So actually, let me start with here. Everyone agrees there shouldn't be prohibition. But I don't know what kind of prohibition, but I mean, I guess there was some police force that could go tell people you can't do that. Okay, maybe there's some things I would tell them to prohibit. But of course, everybody ought to be able to speculate. But I could never figure out what a framework is and what these what kind of success there is, except in some very instrumentalist way. So suppose I say, look, string theory is a kind of framework. Is that a linguistic framework? I don't know, I guess it is. Should I judge it by how much complexity and effort have gone into it? Well, a lot of complexity and effort has gone into it. What have been the results achieved? Well, I'm not sure what I'm supposed to judge there. I would have thought string theory is a proposal, what I would call a metaphysical proposal about what I would call the metaphysical signature, because I'm not sure what you mean. It's a proposal about the world, the ontological structure of the world. It's a proposal that's done in physics about the ontological structure of the world. So you say metaphysics is just ontology, proposals about what there is. From that point of view, if you think the result you're trying to achieve is to get that structure right, then of course there's a big question how we tell whether you've achieved your end, right? And how much effort is it worth to get it right? Well, a whole lot of effort. I mean, I'm not gonna tell the string theorists not to do what they do because it's very complicated. They haven't been able to make predictions, like laboratory predictions. But I'm not sure even what a metaphysical signature is. I don't know how one could, if you think of this as ontology, it sounds like it's just an account of what there is in the world. How could there not fail to be one? And how could it fail to be that what we're trying to do is get that right?
Yeah, I mean, the idea of metaphysical signature is a metaphor, of course, okay? If you think of any of us thought about metaphysics being factual, they thought that there is a way the world is, which is not given to us by physics, chemistry, biology, but by thinking of, you know, being what being is, okay? And so universals and particulars and relations of amplification and instantiation and primary substances and secondary substances and accidental properties and essential properties and relations of dependence and all these kind of categories which go a lot beyond what, you know, maybe string theory or, you know, quantum field theory or whatever said about the world, and which probably they don't need all of these categories to be articulated. But nonetheless, the tradition has it that we need these categories to understand the deep structure of the world, to have a coherent account of what causation is, of how change, how there is change in the world, how things can affect other things. So I take metaphysics to be this kind of enterprise, and very much separate, you know, ordinary physical theory from metaphysics, and I think Carnap would also do the same. So the question about the abstractness, or the abstract entities, whether there are abstract entities or not, you can actually leave it aside when you do arithmetic. But metaphysicians would like to have an answer to this. Are there really abstract entities? Are there abstract particulars, or are they abstract universals? And I think these kind of questions presuppose that there is something in the deep structure of the world which answers them, factually, objectively. So we've got to get it right to understand what the world is like. And I think Carnap, in the way in him, or try to improve on of him, tries to say, now that's not the right way to approach that. The right way to approach is explore frameworks. You might call the proposal, I don't know. I think that's a semantics.
Right, but it all comes down to his claim that these external questions are not factual. I mean, it was the X
there.
And I just think that's wrong. I'm just wondering, what's the argument for?
The argument for this is, I mean, I think the argument for this that at least I would put forward is that I'm agnostic about the factuality. I'm not saying they're not factual. I say that the tradition is presupposed that they're factual. Carnap's argument, I think, was mostly something like, there is no way in which we can settle this question. So it's a kind of a weak or dialogic verification. I don't want to buy into verification, honestly. I'm agnostic about that, but I think you can conceptualize what the aim of metaphysics is, which does not have to presuppose that you've got to answer this question to do ordinary science or understand what the world is like.
Okay, we're running short of time. Very short question from Bill, and a very short answer, and then a very short question from Wayne, and a very short answer.
I'm worried about the extent to which Carnap's account involves taking first-order extensional logic and things that go beyond what could be done with that as the things that would count as metaphysics, because that means that I don't think it can do. Okay, I just want to know how much it's infected by that, because that makes all kinds of reasons to want to go beyond that to just do justice to the way science is done.
Exactly the opposite. I don't think actually even in logical forms and linguistic forms, you could be too liberal and you could do any kind of, you know, logical exploration you want.
Wait.
Yeah, actually, I guess I can put down the speaks exactly to Bill's point. Not enough people pay attention to the opening paragraphs of Empirics and Semantics Ontology. It appeared, I think, in the second edition of Meaning and Necessity, and it's a response to critics of that book, because in Meaning and Necessity, Carnap is talking about intentions. He's counting, saying second order logic, where you quantify over okay, you know, properties. He talks about propositions, and some of his, you know, some people said, hold it, wait, you're supposed to be an empiricist. How can you talk about abstract entities like that? And he says, yeah, the whole point of empiricism semantic ontology is to say, salespeople, it's okay. I'm not doing something that empiricists could object to if I talk about propositions or intentions or other abstract objects. But you know, as Robert pointed out, it's a double-edged sword because, you know, he's saying I'm going to quantify, include these things, you know, in my talk semantics because it's useful. But what's not useful is the sort of traditional questions about the status of both those objects.
Okay, can you make it through? Was nodding enough?
Yep.
Okay, we've got a 10-minute break. Reassemble at 11. And we'll